GSM. In the service of ire.
Welcome back to the GSL Code A. I am Wolf, with me is Calderon. We just saw a pretty cool match. We saw an old GSL veteran fall to Roro, a seeded player, 2-0. And of course, this will mean that Roro will go on to face Slayer's Run, who advanced earlier today.
And our next match is going to be another Terran versus Zerg. Another Startail player has to show his skills against a Kessler player. It is actually Hack, a Terran. And he has to face Rare, another Zerg from Kessler.
Yep. And this is going to be... I think Rare has not shown any televised matches at all. Not in Pro League, not in GSL, not in any exhibition matches at all. He's never shown a single StarCraft 2 match televised. So to go up against Hack here, Hack is going to have some trouble preparing. But at the same time, with all the experience that Hack has and how good of a player he is in general, I think that Rare... Probably, I mean, I think there's a reason why he probably hasn't appeared yet. He's probably not, like, one of the best Kessler players just yet, but he was able to go through the preliminaries, and that's no easy task.
He was able to win one of the Code A qualifier brackets, of course. He took down Brain in the final with a 2-0, and early on, he met one Terran player. It was actually Center, a former TSL, and he won against the Terran player in the second round of his bracket with a 2-0, so he didn't drop a map against him. But as Wolf already mentioned, in regards to televised match, we haven't seen a single one of them, which also means that it was really hard for Hack to prepare for his opponent. He just doesn't have anything that he can base his strategies on. He is actually at the same amount of knowledge of this player that we guys have, so right now, for him, this is the first time that he has faced the style that Rare is going to use, and what exactly is Berserk going to do?
Now that is what we're all looking forward to. He could be a very aggressive all-in player, he could be a late-game guy. We're about to find out. The first map is going to be Entombed Valley. Let's see if Hack can pull things through for Startail here. This is the GSL Code A round of 48, cast by Calderon Wolf.
Starting to the top left of the map, we have our Startail player. His teammate was not able to advance, finds himself in Code B right now. Will this guy be able to make it through the first round? This is...
Startail!
Really focused here, of course, and he is up against a Kessler player. One of the things that really characterized these Code A qualifiers was that we had a lot of Kessler B-teamers that were actually everywhere, and well, one Kessler player was able to make it through this bracket. It was the opponent of Hack. Starting to the bottom right, the Zerg player in blue. He is...
CJ into Sileo.
Just, his first appearance in televised broadcast of StarCraft 2.
Here we have him, and we have cross position. And the first thing that Rare is actually going to do before building anything at all, he sends out a drone to scout what exactly is going on. And he sends it cross position. The Overlord goes to the top right, the drone goes across the map, will scout Hack's build, and you will see that the Terran player does indeed not start with the command center first. Nope, Hack starts things off with the barracks and actually alters the scouting route of his SCV upon scouting his opponent's drone and builds another barracks.
Wow, that is really rare. This is a pretty...
No, this is Hack.
Yeah, well, I... Wow, I wasn't even... Wow.
Yeah, of course. I see what you did there.
No, seriously, I... This is extremely unusual what we're seeing from Hack, and it's been spotted. I'm actually so surprised that he was able to spot this.
The position is just a little bit weird to me, to be honest with you. I mean, Hack sees the drone, and he was sending his SCV to the top right, but he sees the drone coming from the bottom right, so he assumes that his opponent is starting cross position. He decides to build the barracks, but why would you build the barracks in the retreat path of the drone, and not just a little bit more to the right side of the map, just behind those bushes where you can hide it properly?
It actually looks like he is wrong. He's going to go check the bottom left, and so maybe that's why, because he expected the drone to loop around the left side on his way back instead of going through that location. Maybe that's what he thought. Now that he sees the Overlord with his SCV at the bottom, now he knows 100% what's going on. Yeah. And already Rare with two drones to block bunkering, and he's going to be able to defend this no problem. Already six lanes on the way. He may even make a spine crawler. He does, just to be safe.
He needs to. With a spine crawler, you are safe, and we've seen so many Zerg players actually die to a double barracks, even though they scouted what was going on, because they were trying to do it a little bit too greedy. But he's Overlord hunting right now. Hack is Overlord
hunting.
He'll
get one.
Yeah, and that is so huge in the early state of the game.
Overlord gonna get dropped like a hat.
Bam, down, and nothing that he can do about it. And right now,
Hack's going double CC here.
Exactly, he's going for the second expansion. Double expand, no gas just yet. And how many Zerglings did Hack build? 10.
And he's gonna make two Overlords right now. This is the moment, though, where all those Lings are gonna be useful. He doesn't have enough here. Not even close.
He's trying to put them into a good position, and those Marines have a little bit of a problem here. So many Zerglings trying to attack Hack right now. He has the Marines finally at his base and starts to defend immediately.
But that was one way to use your Lings. Trade them against Marines a little bit there. Slows down any of your opponent's pushes he may have wanted to do. He's not going to have any idea about the fast third command center until his Overlord gets in the main, which is really far away right now.
21 to 21 harvesters now, but of course those double command center, those orbitals that he builds, they will be really important later on. And another base to the top right. Wow, look at this. Hack is going for another command center. He takes being greedy to a whole new level.
And he's going to find this Overlord. Oh, wow, this is so smart.
Our
he didn't.
He barely sees it.
And he's not going to kill it, but he's going to keep it away. He almost killed it.
75 hit points left. But this base at the top right, how crazy is that? Look at this guy. He's going for double command center in his base, and then he decides, well, you know what? I actually build another one.
Well, it begs the question even, like, how useful is it? If he's gonna have a ton of minerals, but how is he gonna use that? He's gonna have to do
big
marine pushes.
You've got to be kidding me. There is a Zergling heading to the top right, but wow, that was close. The Zergling actually moving to the left on the minimap for a second. I really thought he would spot it, and I was like, what? Crazy.
Well, he just wants to be sure of anything he can find. I think he may have been trying to spot a Marine move out so he can move another Overlord in position to scout, because he is moving another Overlord across the map. But either way, Hack is going to get a ton of extra resource for this, but he's not going to get any extra gas, not for a long time. He's making two gases right now, taking his second gas in his main and his third gas at the natural. But he's going to be able to add add-ons here, and then he wants to dump a ton of resources in these barracks. And actually, he's taking one of his gases at the top right base.
Exactly.
That's really not what I expected.
Really smart here, though, to actually saturate those refineries first. Rare, on the other hand, is now going for the Baneling Nest. And this game is shaping up to be very, very different from what we usually see. So at this point, Hack is already getting double factory. He wants to go for mech play later. But this is just him being very, very... I want to say he's very, very greedy. Is he really going to go for mech, or will we just see him with a huge amount of Hellions and also the Marines that he builds with those four barracks that he has?
I think he could do both. Because he's not making any Marines at this moment in time. We'll see if he does continue that. Does start two more Marines and a Starfort with the factory, so I think he may just go Marine Tank. Yeah, he's starting Siege Mode and he's continuing Marine production. This is kind of weird, but he's going to have so much production once that fourth orbital really kicks in.
And with all those mules that he can use, of course, his income in regards to minerals is now just crazy. And he has the extra gas as well, therefore he can support those two factories that he has in his main base. And all the scouting information that Rare gets right now will mislead him.
Yeah, that's the best point, because he has no idea what's going on. He just thinks that there's no third base. And as far as I know, he still doesn't know if there's even a third command center. Yeah, so he's just trying to prepare for a normal game here. He is getting his upgrades pretty quick. The one thing that this build really hurts Hack in is that he cannot really pressure. He will be able to pressure in a few minutes, but right now, he kind of has to sit back, and he is playing a little bit risky, so basically has to sit back and hope that his base doesn't get scouted, while his opponent's creep spread is going really nice. It's completely undenied.
And of course, now we also have Rare on three bases, something that we didn't really point out yet, but it's pretty obvious. You have seen on the minimap as well.
He's switching the mech.
Exactly. Another factory has been built, and we have double armory here, but also the engineering bay. With 18 Marines on the map, he stopped his Marine production for now. He's getting more SCVs, takes another gas at the top right, and even gets his third, well, basically his fourth base right now. Going for a couple of Banshees, Heck with his economy, can basically afford right now to do whatever he wants.
Yeah, that's very true. Zerg player's mineral economy right now is slightly better when there are no mules on the map, but when the mules land, it becomes insane how much he can do, how much he can produce. With the armories coming down, he's going to be able to get the upgrades out, but the upgrades of Rare are already slightly ahead. He's got the infestation put up as well. But if Rare misreads this and doesn't make a Roach Warren, for example, there could be a lot of timings that really shake him up a little bit.
At this point in time, we have Rare just trying to go for the normal game.
Will he get in the main? He will! Oh, he sees the armories. He knows.
Yeah, he has seen the armories and he has seen another factory being produced. The Roach one should be built fairly soon.
Immediately.
There it is. And at the same time, to the top right, as you could just see on screen, we still have this fourth base going strong for Hack. And this gives him the extra income. With the mech style that he chose, it's of course really important to have this extra gas.
And getting the Raven is really cool. A lot of people try to skip that, but I think it's so important. It helps you clean up the creep, helps you deal with queens, even spore crawlers if you want to switch into more air later on. But just most importantly for the creep and detection.
Mech is just so strong these days, and a lot more popular than it was just a few weeks and months ago. But since MVP has used it at IAM, we've seen a lot more Terran players use it against Zerg. Especially at WCS Europe, it was one of the most favorite strategy for Terran players to use against Zerg player. And also successful, because it's really strong to take down this mech army. On the other hand, if a Terran player loses his mech army, it's really tough for him to rebuild.
Exactly.
If he doesn't have a huge bank and the factories that he needs to pull it off.
When you go mech, you need your third base with gas to be able to produce appropriately. This is why it's really confusing for Rare, because he's like, no third base. Pretty sure no third base. He's like, but he's got a lot of factories over there. I don't get it. And Hack has taken a huge risk here, but now he's got four bases, and a third base is not even known about yet.
Now he's running to the top right, but he's just trying to set up a flank here. He's not really scouting.
Yeah.
And the problem is, even if this base to the top right is scouted, at this point, it was well worth it.
Absolutely. It's going to take a lot of units to go over there to take that out.
The Baneling. Wow, just spotted by the Raven. Immediately being taken out before he could be used. Also, of course, a nice use for the Banshee here as well, for the Raven.
Yeah. Just, he knows now, he's like, well, I can't use these traps anymore. Not even going to be able to hide the Zerglings around the map very easily.
Two additional starports because he can and because he wants to.
And he knows that
prepare.
The Greater Spire, yeah, exactly. He knows the Greater Spire is going to be a problem. But he's attacking at such a timing that it's going to be uncomfortable to even spend resources on Corruptors right now, because this attack is something he must defend. He's got no spines. His Roach count right now is at 16 only. He needs a lot more than that. He needs to connect with these Banelings, but will he be able to? The tanks are already sieged.
Banelings will not be the answer with 15 Blue Flame Hellions on the map.
Yeah,
that's,
and they have plus one as well.
Is he trying to
flank
here?
He's going to go for a run by and try to catch reinforcements, but...
Well, he can catch the reinforcements, but he cannot deal with the huge army that we have for Hack right now. He's nearly maxed, and just look at all these Hellions.
Yeah.
Zerglings, he's building so many Zerglings, and yes, there are Banelings, of course, as well, but we still have 60 Zerglings here on the map, and he just won't be able to make them work against this army composition.
It's never going
to
be cost-efficient. Not even the Banelings really are going to be cost-efficient, but this many siege tanks, and if he connects against Thors, it's not useful. Hitting the Hellions is good, but can he hit the Hellions? He has to be able to do that. That's not easy either when they're being microed back against the siege tanks. This is a very uncomfortable position for Rare. And actually, Hack is going to go home with the damage he's done, or at least attempt to.
Oh.
Nice trap here on these tanks.
And he's not working with those. Now he's working with the Thors, but a little bit too late. He already lost a fair amount of units. Now those Hellions are being shielded by the Thors, trying to take down not only the Banelings, but also the Zerglings, of course. He needs to back up here. He's immediately rebuilding his army, making a fair trade work for him.
Yeah, and that's what I mean. You know, when you fight Banelings against Hellions, it's like, oh, they're great against Hellions if you can hit them. And if you can micro the Hellions, as we just saw there, they're not very useful. And Hack, with all the bank he's built up, having that extra base, which is still unscouted, is able to remake so many units. Right now he's making 5 Vikings at a time, already preparing for that Broodlord transition. There are 5 Broodlords on the way as well right now.
And we have still the 4th base to the top right. At the same time, he secures himself a 5th. His opponent, Rare, is just trying to double expand once again after his 4th was killed.
There's no upgrades for Air right now for Rare either. He hasn't even started +1 or Carapace or anything, so the Thors and the Vikings are going to do so much damage to them.
And Heck is trying to use one of the best things that you can pull off when you actually use Mech. He's trying to use those Blue Flame Hellions for run-bys into the economy at the exposed expansion of his opponent. And he's killing with a nice position. A lot of Zerglings here also trying to take down more drones as we speak. He's always just forcing Rare to defend.
Yeah, he's killing so many drones. And he wants to free up supply anyways so he can make more Thors. Immediately starts two additional Thors. And Rare is against the mech army behind in supply. He's building a composition that Hack has already prepared for. And now Hack's doing the Ghost Academies. He's got the Seeker Missile finishing up right now as well.
He wants nukes. His name actually means nuke in Korean, yeah. And he wants them. He wants to nuke the hell out of Rare here. Even builds a lot of additional command centers, and I guess a couple of those will be transformed into planetaries.
I'm actually just really impressed with Hack's play. Just no real mistakes this entire game. A risk was taken, sure, in the beginning, but after that, he's transitioned so beautifully, not missing a beat with his production.
Finally, the scout.
Yeah, he sees it now, and I wonder if he clicked on those geysers and was like, oh my god.
Yeah, there's nuke number one being built, and
Corvid reactor
cloaking.
Yep, cloaking, high psych auto tracking, all the upgrades you'd ever want as a Terran player, he's getting them. He's trying to throw away SCVs, using them as scouts as well. So many orbitals going down.
He had so many SCVs, he could definitely get rid of a few of them. And here comes an attack by Rare trying to get in here. And we have the first base at the bottom right. He came off into a planetary. Yes, he's losing SCVs, but he couldn't certainly live with it because he was at roughly 80, 85. Now he's down to 70. Much better count for him. And just look at this mech army making short notice of all these roaches
and
circling.
I just clicked on the refineries, man, and about in total, 3,000 gas was mined from these bases. He lives up here, but he already got the 3,000 gas. Sorry, Rare.
All those extra upgrades that he has that he can afford with this incredible economy, it is just insane. Resources lost are fairly even a little bit better for Hack than it is for Rare. But let's not forget that the Zerg player is also on 180 supply now and is on 5 bases, 6 bases actually after all.
Yeah. He's got the drone count for both players 79 to 59. Obviously, with 59 being the SCVs, with all the mules he has, he's not too concerned about his harvest account. That's why we saw him throw his SCVs away earlier.
I mean, this guy is going for 2 additional command centers, and he already has 5 mules on the map, and he can build call down additional ones whenever.
Ghosts will he make, and how is he going to use them exactly? Because all right, he starts 3 ghosts right away, but that's all he can make because he's maxed. How many tech labs does he have? He's got, okay, still just the 4 barracks, he's got all of them with a tech lab. We may see, as MVP is also known for doing, late game ghosts all over the place.
He's going to snipe the Broodlords. He's like, yes, I know Blizzard nerfed it, but I'm gonna use it anyway because I can.
This is pretty cool, by the way. This planetary just barely finishing in time to help out here, but he's going to lose several SCVs over that.
He's building another silo right now to get another nuke.
Yes.
He will use those those ghosts, I think, only to use the nukes.
I think you're right. I don't think he's going to try to use them for sniping. He's going to just keep about 3 to 4 in total always on the map.
You can try to EMP the Infestors, but I think this is much easier for him to put them to some use, and he certainly has the economy to back it up.
He's actually just throwing away supply and some tanks right now. That's how much money he has.
Yeah.
He's actually put these siege tanks on autopilot because the drivers got all the siege tanks to drive their Ferraris home because that's how much money he has.
This is no mistake, guys. He definitely wants to get rid of the siege tanks because he realized that his opponent does have a lot less roaches now, only 2 remaining, and therefore he can't really put those siege tanks to use. He needs something against the air army. He needs additional starports, and he wants to go for battlecruisers as well.
Yeah. And by the way, the ghosts have moved in.
And the ghosts already scouted how many broodlords and how many prophets we have. And here comes the first nuclear missile.
He's got overseers, but he was on move command. He does take out the first, but the second one comes down. It's actually going to hit several overlords as well as the Baneling Nest.
Getting a fair amount of overlords.
And he's actually not focused on that because he's worrying about the mech on the left. The nuke is going to get on the larva and boom. He likes those, not Rare, but he likes them well cooked. Kaldor, and here comes the attack. Broodlord's actually eating some fire here, and a Seeker missile hit on the Corruptors.
Not only one, there are a lot of Seeker missiles. On the other hand, the Zerg player has built up a fair bank. Can he actually overpower Hack? He's using his bundles now, and all those Corruptors. Look at this amount of Corruptors that we currently have. Even with the Thors, it's gonna be a problem. But Hack, he keeps continuing to nuke. He's building three additional ones right now. But still, CJ and Tosria, he has a very, very scary army. And although we have a lot of expansions for Hack, he is a bit hard-pressed here.
Yeah, he really is. He's actually making more command centers because he has a problem with his mineral bank. So he wants to drop as many mules as possible. He's got the command centers, but not the SCVs. And just taking out more and more investors to the top right. And he's got changelings to deal with over here. They are going to be taking out nice snipes there on the ghost, but the Corruptor count is now up to 24, and that's going to be his big issue. But will he split the Corruptors? Because there's so much AoE damage to fight these Corruptors with the nukes, with the Thor shots, with the Seeker missiles, and even with point defense drones. He's going to have to make sure that his Corruptors are well split, that they can do the damage they need, and he's going to have to couple that with great Fungals. If he doesn't have good Fungals, he will never be able to beat Hack's army.
This is the Zerg death ball. A lot of Corruptors, 10 to 12 Broodlords, and of course the Infestors as a support.
Kelder, he's just going to trade these Banes for the Planetary. Yeah. A great choice, because this is actually going to limit his opponent's mineral income so much.
He's able to hold it!
It's because of the building armor, otherwise it would have died.
Yes, building armor.
He counted
armor.
It and he was like, alright, it takes this many Banelings to kill it, but not with building armor.
And of course also the Planetary taking down a couple of Banelings before they could actually hit.
That's true as well, yeah.
Oh, that was so worth it.
I don't even know how many Banelings it takes to kill a Planetary.
I think it was 13.
Yeah, something like that.
13 or 16.
Another nuke going off here. The Legends nuke. View ability. Oh, wow, that's actually a beautiful location to nuke from.
What does he actually nuke the bottom left?
He just queued that one up without even knowing if there was a hatchery.
Yeah,
there was.
I think so, too.
Those drones moved, but it didn't matter. He killed all of them at that base.
Wow, and the base is nearly dead as well. The ghost can actually take down the expansion if he wants to. And another nuke. He doesn't want to kill this hatchery. He wants to completely shred it to pieces.
Now, with the nuke at the bottom left, there's a lot of radiation left over. The Zerg's going to think twice about making a hatchery there, and this hatchery will fall.
He could actually nuke across this small abyss at the bottom
left.
I
think he will as soon as he has that nuke ready, which he does now. It just finished.
But guys, keep in mind that Rare has the better bank here. And now, once again, we have the fight, and the Thors really get their shots off while
EMP.
The Infestors are trying to take down the siege tanks, but the EMPs, they are good.
They are really good.
Oh, wow.
He needs the Seeker missiles. Oh, my God! The Seeker missiles killed so many Corruptors just then, but this time the Fungal is good. He needs another one. Will he get it? He wants to. He doesn't have enough energy. There he goes. He hits it.
The Fungal is good indeed, and
another
wow,
nuke.
They are still alive, but can they take down the army? Yes, they can!
There's another nuke to the south as well. It's going to take out these drones. He's not paying attention. He's going to lose all of them.
Wow.
Every single one.
All those Vikings in the fight were going Obama, the Willa Gassing. Can we do it? Yes, we can! And they take down the Corruptors. They take down the Broodlords.
And now he's on full retreat. The Broodlords are trying to escape. A nice pickoff here dodges the Fungal as well. And the bank for Hack is not good. He needs to repair these Vikings. That's absolutely something he should consider doing right now, because replacing them cost for cost is not going to be very efficient for him. Another nuke goes off at this base, starting to take more hit points, and he cannot mine from it.
This game is insane. I love it. We started off with such a weird, weird start, and then suddenly we find ourselves in a 30-minute game where we see nukes, we see battlecruisers, plus three for the Terran. The Zerg with the perfect combination. The Terran player still going strong. An amazing, amazing match that we have right now between those two players.
He's just damaging this hatchery over time with nukes. He actually will get the spines as well here. That was a mistake moving those like that. Not too big of a deal considering he's not harassing with Hellions anymore. The auto repair on these Vikings is starting to take its toll. The Viking is almost all up to full hit points now.
Every single Viking will return full HP, and then he can use them once again.
He's even repairing the Thors as well here.
We have 11 Infestors still. We have 22 Corruptors, but now Battlecruisers are joining the battle as well. It's not only the forward Viking composition that is up against the CJ and Tosria now. No, it's also the Battlecruisers, and they have the upgrades. The Ravens with the Seeker missiles are so important to attack those clustered up Corruptus. It's just an incredible game.
And he's going to try to save this Command Center using the Blue Flame Hellions over here on the right side. Now, no weapon refit, no Behemoth Reactor, but as mentioned, the upgrades for the Battle Cruisers are going to be 3-3 for air. The Corruptor's upgrades right now, I'm not mistaken. Yeah, he's just got 2-2 on those, so he hasn't even started 3-3. A little bit behind in that regard. Another nuke goes off, this time again at the hatchery that's weakened to the south. And he pulls the drones away, but that does not stop the damage on the hatchery. He's actually got an Overseer nearby. He's going to try to kill the ghost.
Oh.
And it's too late. But the hatchery lives.
Nearly down. Yeah, it just lives.
All he has to do is drop another ghost over there and shoot it 3 times, and it will die. Plus 3 now on the way for those Broodlords. And the Battlecruiser, there's just one in the mix here, but that's a great supplementary unit. It's so difficult to deal with. It takes so many shots. It tanks so many shots.
But right now we have just Hack using all these nukes, which is so smart, especially with all the money that he has. He can just completely throw the Zerg off guard. Every single time one of these nukes goes off, Rare has to scout where that is happening, what's going on, if he is losing some drones here, or whatever is happening on the map. So a lot of map awareness here with Hack, forced. A really great game by both of them, and still we have those Infestors sneaking in, although we had those two missile turrets.
Yeah, I guess he just didn't quite see. A few mules will be taken out. Meanwhile, we have... Is that triple nuke? No, just one at a time. I thought he might nuke 3 times in the same location. He's gonna go nuke at that other hatchery, but it was transfused up to 1,000 resources or hit points, so he's not gonna be able to actually kill it.
So many nukes, nice. The first one goes down, takes on a lot of harvesters, and if this nuke actually hits, and I think it will, he's going to lose every single one of these drones, and he does!
He actually scans to see. Oh. He wanted to see so badly, he thought it was worth a scan. He's like, did I kill him?
A couple of them actually survives. A fungal ends the life of this ghost. The guy was a hero,
63
a sniper. And he's actually taking down creep tumors with his SCVs. Hack is certainly having some fun here right now.
He really is, but this game is not over. 6 more orbitals on the way. He's actually running out of money slowly but steadily at some of his external satellite bases right now.
On the other hand, we have Rare with no gas left. He just has 100. That's not enough. And here comes the fight once again.
Oh, these Broodlords are so stacked up here! And the Seeker missiles! Four of them
launched! Oh my god!
The damage has been done!
Oh,
there's a great combo on the Vikings!
This is the apocalypse right now for both of them! Look at this amount of fungals of Seeker missiles! Four damage done to those clustered up units! Both are dropping in supply!
More
like
nukes!
Crazy!
Another nuke to the south, and GG!
What an insane first game! Wolf, what was that?
That was...
The
GSL. That was actually a hidden third base into a fake four barracks and the mech into airplay, into nuclear tactical strikes versus what
you like to call the
Zerg death ball. There was one hero battlecruiser which did participate in the final fight, and there was a lot of multitasking going on by both players, but Rare actually was outclassed a little bit there, and he did not split his units. We talked about how important that is against Seeker missiles, Thor shots, all of his Broodlords were on like one hex.
Yeah.
That is just asking for death.
Exactly, that is just asking for the pain. I think those guys were, I don't know, they had a death wish right there.
Well, you know, using the ghost like he did is so difficult to deal with because you have to know exactly where the ghost is. You can't like make spine crawlers to stop that. You have to send groups of lings around with overseers to kill those ghosts. And every single time he killed a ghost, Hack used the one medevac he had to drop them down at the same location again. It was, I mean, no fault on Rare's part really on defending the ghost, just really well executed and very, I don't know how to call it, like sophisticated ghost use from Hack. It was just very patient and calculated.
This game was very, very entertaining indeed. And Rare actually with a tablet right there and his own picture. What is that?
A lot of Kessel players actually will bring a tablet into the booth with sponsor pictures, family pictures, things like that to kind of cheer themselves up in the booth. It's pretty cool actually. I like to see that. It's okay. Probably actually the new Samsung Galaxy 10.1 Note tablet.
That's
a pretty cool tablet, man.
Yeah, that's actually a good point.
But this is CJ Antis player, so actually I was like thinking I was like trying to be clever and be like, I'm just trying to plug a sponsor, but actually now that I think about it, it's probably an iPad.
Well, be it as it may, we are heading into the second game fairly soon. So far, we are actually not in the lobby, but we are just waiting for the invite. There might be technical problem right now. But still, this last game was really entertaining. It wasn't too rally, and of course, the first game that we have in the best of three series. So a very entertaining match already just shaping up here. Do you think that we will see something different, similar?
Think about how game number one really started. The weird second barracks where he assumed the players to the bottom left. He's wrong. Drone sees his barracks. He has to transition. He still wins the game by making some great decisions like a fast three commander and a hidden fourth.
Yep.
But on a game like this, I want to see what the map is before I go any further. Okay, it's going to be Abyssal City. So a big map, but it's a two-player map. What if he just does double proxy racks, but this time like really far forward, both of them together? Because his opponent's probably already forgotten about how he opened last game by now, or at least he's not really thinking about that too much. He's probably worried about the late game. He's like, oh, I hope he doesn't go mech again on this map.
And players haven't figured out Abyssal City just yet. It's one of the new additions to the map pool, and therefore, where would you actually place down those barracks? Where would you hide them? Where would you scout for them? You know,
yeah,
these are all questions that we haven't answered yet.
That's a good point. There's a few places I feel like to the north, if you spawn the left side, or to the south, you spawn the right side, where that would be good, because the Overlord path is likely going to be the opposite way. But that's not necessarily the case. It depends on how he wants to send the Overlords. I don't even know the Overlord pathing that well on this map because I've only cast it just a few times and very few times, if at all, in this matchup. So,
yeah, right now we're just waiting for players to start things up here, and then we'll find out if Rare is able to get back into this best of three or if he will fall victim to the Startale player with a 2-0. Here we have both of them once again.
Yep, and the countdown has started. Rare making his first appearance. That was his first televised match ever for StarCraft II, and it was an exciting one. Hack, a veteran, a Startale Terran, so strong, really showed it last game. We'll see if his multitasking comes through again. The map is Abyssal City. This is the GSL Code A round of 48 with Kaldor and Wolf.